Hello, 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 everybody. I have no idea whether this is going to work or not because of internet, Melbourne lockdown, remote learning, and parents, educators, people working from home, and internet. Between 9 and 3, it's horrific, absolutely horrific. But I'm going to do my best. Hi, Kate. How are you going? How are you surviving? Are you in Melbourne? I think you might be, but I might have that wrong. I think it's probably a weird time for me to come on and do a live as well, because most people are engaged with something at this point. Hi, Nancy. Hi, Libby. Hi, Lynn. Hi, Victoria. Adelaide. Oh, gosh. Okay. So, let's first of all get this out of the way. Let's all have a little giggle at my hair. See that? That's called I slept in hair. It's called I'm so tired at the moment, adjusting to winter like a big old bear that wants to hibernate. And hi, Winter. Hi, Marcella. I may have pronounced that wrong. Marcella. And yeah, I was running late for a 9 a.m. So got up, did this gorgeous look at it. Oh my Lord, somebody help me. Anyway, they weren't able to make their session this morning. My daughter had decided to go in the bath at 1:30 a.m. That's a great time for a bath. God love our children. God bless them. So what I'm talking about, and I've only got a little bit because my husband's off to work shortly. Oh yeah, Nancy. From the future here, from the future, a parent has sent a question in, and it's around why, and I guess this is probably, I mean, this is appropriate for everybody, autistic or not, but also this is in reference specifically to PDA, pathological demand avoidance, but it's also common for all children who are neurodivergent. Sometimes when I come into session with parents, they will talk to me about how their children have been in school for some time, and when they finally have a break from school, families expect, if they've had a really hard time in the school system and they're finally withdrawn, or we get to school holidays or school break, families often expect that when their children are having a hard time in the school system, that that break will see them calming down and being happier and their mental health improving. Sometimes that happens. Sometimes we see the opposite. So what happens is they may have new behaviours that we haven't seen before. They may be incredibly anxious to the point where they won't leave their room. They are largely engaged with their screens or unable to leave the house at all. There may be changes in their diet. They may be food restricting. They might start bedwetting. They might be really aggressive, hygiene-y. And families can often be confused about what is going on when their child was highly distressed in the school environment and now they're home and they're not having to go to school anymore. It's quite complex, really. When we're PDAers, we are hugely determined human beings. So for me, all of my life, I had gross, chronic, ongoing anxiety. But because I have a PDA profile, that meant that if I really wanted to do something like going to school, studying, going to uni, going to work, whatever it is, it didn't matter how gross my anxiety was. I'd push through and I'd force myself into those situations. So I had this ongoing battle, internalized battle all the time of, you know, my anxiety being this organic protective process that believes its one job is to keep me alive. And then there's the conscious thinking me that's like, okay, yes, I'm anxious, but I really want to do this thing. I'm really going to do this thing. Now, in many ways, that's hugely positive to have the toolkit to be able to move forward to live the life we want to live. However, inside of that for the autistic person is that really important neurobiological process that is saying, stop, rest, listen to what the brain and body are signaling to us. Because as autistic people, we are largely hypersensitive beings, very, very highly sensitive in every sense of the word. So we need much more rest, downtime. And when we don't give ourselves that, and we push beyond those organic limits that we have, we're headed for trouble. We are headed for trouble. A lot of people assume that autistic children with a PDA profile don't want to go to school. That's true for some PDA children. And then there are the PDAers who really want to be at school, who push themselves beyond their neurobiological limits. So we have ourselves in a situation where we know that we suffer when we go into that environment, but our conscious process is that we really want to be there. We really enjoy learning. We really want to be with our friends. And so we try and try and try. And then what happens is we get to school holidays, or we finish up with school, and we are burnt out. That's when burnout hits. That's when trauma hits, because the brain doesn't care about details. The brain doesn't care. It doesn't know what our conscious thinking is. The brain only understands the language of sensory input. So the information the brain has is what we can see, smell, taste, feel, and hear. It doesn't tap into what I'm thinking consciously. So taking that into consideration, what we're doing is exposing our bodies, our physiological being, to an environment that our brain believes is a threat, a huge threat to us, because school, as an example, is a cesspool of demands, it is a sensory bombardment, and it is largely unpredictable, even though we may have routines. And look, I'm not the kind of autistic person that does routine. I don't like routine. I'm a PDAer, so I prefer spontaneity, autonomy, and freedom. So when we come out of that situation and we've pushed and pushed and pushed ourselves, our neurobiological process is, oh my God, thank God, finally, we are not pushing ourselves beyond our limits. Finally, you're listening. So then we find ourselves in a position of absolute burnout. And that can look like a number of things, but also for children, it can look like trauma. Now, if you have a PDA expression of autism, pathological demand avoidance, terrible name. Somebody's just asked me to talk about what is the PDA definition. I'll get to that in a second. It's a terrible name, but it's largely focused on the most predominant behavior, which is to avoid demands. But if you have a PDA, autistic expression, then you'll know that our brains are structured in a very similar way to a brain that has experienced significant trauma. And there's a very fine line between pushing beyond our natural limits to do something that we want to engage with and tipping ourselves over into trauma. And that can look like a million different things. So if you take a child and withdraw them from school, you may very well see escalated anxiety, aggressive behavior, changes in their eating, sleeping, toileting, all of those things. Now, it's really important to understand that there's a distinct difference in a person or a child's conscious thinking and their neurobiological response. So remembering that that neurobiological response does not give a damn about details. It doesn't know what your wants and desires are. It's just purely primal, animal. That's our animal brain. So it goes, we need to survive. Our conscious thinking is about what do we want and need and what are our emotional responses. This here, the neurobiological process, just goes, what information are we getting from our senses and how much of that is a threat? How much of it is safe? So you can do copious amounts of talking therapy with people with a PDA profile. But if it doesn't work, that's not surprising to me, because again, primal brain doesn't care about talk therapy. It doesn't care about details. We need to be communicating directly with the neurobiological process. And we do that by bypassing the person's conscious thinking. Is this making sense? It's difficult to put a lot of detail into this. Where are we? Talking just isn't working. Yeah, talking probably won't work. Yeah, okay, cool. Because the reality is, if talking was going to be effective for little PDAers or big PDAers, we wouldn't be PDAers. We have a distinct neurobiology. We're autistic people, but we also have an overactive threat response, which means if you are a PDAer, you live a lot of your life in fight, flight, freeze, or fawn. Often, I'm a very relaxed person in my own environment. However, I check in regularly with my body and it's always tense. It's always tensed up. And that is fight, flight, freeze, or fawn. That's the threat response. So even when my mind is completely relaxed, the neurobiology still is overactive. And still tenses up my body ready to do whatever I need to do to get the hell out of there. So, please explain more about the sensory primal. It's all making so much sense. Can you just explain more about examples of the sensory stuff? Yeah. So the sensory stuff is our limited five senses. So what we can smell, see, taste, feel, and here, and there are memory associations in there. So for autistic people, we have different sensory processing, which means that we may be sensitive to sound, we may be tactile defensive, so we don't like to be touched a lot. And it can be the opposite. Everybody is different, but basically autistic people have sensitivities, or they are largely sensory seeking, or a bit of both. So everyone's different. But if you go into a school environment and there's lots of people, and let's just focus on maybe a five-year-old prep classroom as an example, just checking the time. we also tap into senses that other people can't see or may not be aware of. So energy is the first language. It's our native tongue for autistic people. Verbal communication is not our native tongue. It's energy, what we feel about other people. We're able to sense the intentions and motivations of others as PDAers. So if a person is not honest and transparent in the way they present themselves to us, we'll know straight away. Now that is another form of sensory input, energy. We can tell whether someone is an angry person, whether somebody is giving off a loving, nurturing, kind, open, accepting energy. We respond really well to that. But we know, we can feel into who people are, we can feel into environments. Now, you take a 5-year-old autistic child and put them in a classroom with, say, 20, even 10, even 5 other 5-year-olds, and the energy is happy and excitable and fun. That is still unstable, chaotic, unpredictable energy. So even if our conscious thinking process as little autistic people is, wow, this is so much fun. If you have a PDA profile, the brain is going to be responding to that energy and going, what's going on here? Not safe. And then every day that we go back into that environment, if we are not working on communicating directly with that primal brain to de-escalate that threat response and calm down that anxiety, then we continue to go into an environment that our conscious thinking thinks is really fun and awesome, but our primal brain goes, no. And the next morning we'll wake up and we'll want to go to school, but our primal brain will say, uh-uh. Now that brain is wise and intelligent, remembering its job is to keep us alive. So it will employ a range of strategies in fight, flight, freeze or fawn to disengage us or to prevent us from engaging with something it decides is threatening. And that can be not being able to get out of bed because we're absolutely exhausted. It can be aggressive behavior, which is fight, bringing us back to our animal nature, our primal nature. It can be giving us a migraine, giving us a pain in the tummy, a whole range of physiological aspects to disengage us, to protect us. So we need to communicate with the neurobiological brain, that process, sorry. Fight, flight, freeze, and fawn, F-A-W-N. Fawn is when we adapt in order to maintain a level of control. So we might befriend the angry person and get on side with them so that they won't target us. But yes, these are the reasons why when our children say, I really want to go to school, but I can't, they're telling the truth. But they don't have the capacity to understand what's going on inside of them. And they don't have the ability to express why they want to go to school, but they can't. And because by nature as human beings, we are so centered on and focused on behavior, which is human expression, what's going on the outside, we might look at that and go, oh, of course you can. Come on, you've been to school before. The more we do that, the more we apply pressure and the more we invalidate or dismiss, even when that's not our intention, the more the primal brain kicks in. So it's a very delicate process that is very challenging to navigate. But it's important to know when our children say, I really want to go to school, but I can't, that they're telling the truth. What has worked for you to communicate with the neurobiological brain to inform it that all is well? Great question, Sarah. I do have to finish up right now. But I'm happy to come back and talk about that in a live another time. But I just wanted to touch on a question that was emailed to me around why, when our children finally get a break, they might start escalating in what is difficult or challenging behaviour. And I guess I want to finish on this. When our children are engaging in behaviour that a lot of people would look in and see as naughty, or people would disapprove of, it is so important that we recognize that behavior as burnout, exhaustion, struggle, lacking the ability to communicate. That behavior is communication. So there is this saying, and I really love it, and I know we've probably all heard of it, which is good. Our children are not giving us a hard time, they are having a hard time. And whenever my children are in that situation, the first thing I say is, "Oh, sweetheart, are you having a hard time today?" And it diffuses and it shows me their real state of being. They might start flooding with tears or expressing their sadness and their frustration. Because when we continue to put pressure on our children when they've told us they can't do something, we risk influencing the process of them internalizing self-hatred and self-loathing and self-rejection and self-abandonment. Because I know what it's like to be a little person and to not be able to do things that are simple for other people, and then to think there's something wrong with me and to blame myself. We know the tension that arises in our families when we are having a hard time. So if we can support ourselves to be responsive to our children rather than reactive, that is key. Anyway, thank you all for being here. I must go. My husband's off to work and we've got some remote learning and other things to do. I hope you all have an incredible weekend, and thank you so much for being here.